that will stand forever.
Singing, singing, yes I am.
And are you standing in the place that can stand the weather?
Singing, singing, yes I am.
Oh, in the kingdom, one by one. In the kingdom,
oh, put your hands together, come on.
In the kingdom, for His Son. In the kingdom, we
all right.
In the kingdom, side by side. In the kingdom, one and all. In the kingdom, will I die. In the kingdom, will I fall.
Are you walking the road that will lead to heaven?
Away in the water, oh, oh, oh.
This is Chris Reed in Sweden for ICOC Hot News on the churches in the Baltics and Nordics. Today we're going to show you what it's like evangelizing in our part of the world, where it's not just atheistic, in many cases it's actually even anti-Christian. To give you an example, we took to the streets in Stockholm, Sweden, and asked people what they believe. Tro och kärlek, do you have faith in anything?
Well, I believe in peace and love.
I would consider myself an agnostic.
I don't believe in any god or something like that.
There is no god.
I don't know for sure if I don't have a soul or if there is no god. I don't live by the religions, but I like their ideas.
Thank you for your time. That was about the most open discussion I've had in 6 months. Feeling pretty good about getting a good Bible study going on with him. Here in Stockholm, over half the church was originally met by someone on the street. So the church trains its members on how to start conversations with strangers that surfaces their needs for God. Several faithful disciples are making a great impact in their communities. This is Levi in Oslo, Norway.
I Norge så liker ikke folk noe særlig organisert religion, og spesielt ikke gudstjenester. Så det vi gjør at vanligvis må vi kanskje invitere mer enn 150 personer bare for å få en til å komme, til og med om det et morsomt arrangement hvis det sammen med kirken. For noen måneder siden så kom jeg opp med en litt ny idé. Jeg tok og brukte Instagram til å invitere folk til å snakke om sin tro over en kopp kaffe. Det var ganske enkelt, men det tok litt av, og innen noen få uker så hadde jeg over 1000 kontakter. Og aviser og radioprogrammer inviterte meg til å komme og snakke om det. På vår første bibeldiskusjon så hadde vi da 9 helt nye gjester. Nå bruker jeg kanskje 1-2 timer hver dag for å nå ut til folk på sosiale medier, og jeg kan nå ut til like mange mennesker nå på 30 dager som det ville tatt meg kanskje 2-3 år å gjøre tidligere ansikt til ansikt.
Over in Tallinn, Estonia, instead of women's days, the church runs what they call Women's Cafe several times a year. Women's ministry leader Trine gave us the details.
In a country where not so many people believe in God, it's somehow strange to come to church. So one day we got an idea. Why not make a cafe? Come and buy a cup of coffee and a nice cake and really chat for 2 hours. And it really worked. 30 sisters and about 30 visitors came. So we have total strangers and they talk about the most hurtful things on their heart. And it's amazing. And they build trust and they come and they meet again. And now we have women's cafes 3 times in spring and 3 times in fall. We were thinking if we only have like 1 person getting baptized, that was all worth it. But by now, we have already 10 people become a disciples. People who got baptized, they later shared that they were touched by the life stories of the woman who was sharing. And I'm happy to say now that many other churches are having their own women's cafes now.
And that's some hot news from the Nordics and the Baltics. Please be praying for this part of the world.
Amen. Good morning. So now is the time of our service. We kind of call a welcome, but I feel we've already been welcomed by music and video. And so just want to share this morning kind of why I think for me, I guess personally, that it's important that we meet together, and why do we come to church? And it's interesting, I was flipping on Facebook this morning, I don't know how many of you guys do that, but I came across something that I thought, wow, this is semi-insightful but challenging. But somebody had posted, it says, if we don't teach our children to follow Christ, then the world will teach them not to. And I think about it for us, if we don't teach one another how to follow Christ, daily the world is going to teach us not to. And so I think about, well, why do we come together? We have to know about Christ. We can have friendships, relationships, and all these different things, but it really comes down to Christ on us being Christians. We're not Kevinisms. We're not Caseyisms. We're not Kenisms. We're Christians. And so we're here to follow Jesus. We're here to learn about Jesus. So why come together? It's to grow in our strength and faith in Christ. Because the world's going to beat us down day by day. But it's only when we can come together that we can strengthen one another in our faith in Christ. So turn with me, if you would, to Ephesians chapter 2. And I was trying to think, well, what's the most encouraging scripture I could share with everybody this morning? And I thought, you know, it really comes back down to Christ. It really comes back down to knowing Jesus. And in Ephesians, starting in chapter 2, I'm going to start in verse 11. And it says, therefore, so remember, you got to read the part that came before this later, but for now, it says, therefore, remember that formerly we who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ and excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace, and in this body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to those who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole body is joined together and rises to become a holy temple to the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. And so you realize Paul is writing this to a group of people that some of them were Gentile believers, some of them were Jewish believers, but the two had been separated for so long because of the faith of Israel, because of what they thought it was to follow God. He's like, no, this is a mystery that was clarified through Christ. That no, we're all united. We're all have the opportunity through Christ to be part of God's household. So it doesn't matter whether we're young, old, black, white, rich, poor. Through Christ, we can be brothers and sisters. Amen. So my thought this morning is, so when you think of family, what do you think of? Do you think of the people in this room? Is this your family? Is this these are the members of my household? Are your closest relationships here? Are they really looking at, I want to be close to my brothers and sisters, because we got the same dad up in heaven. I remember there's a brother that used to live here, those of you that know him, Chad Hughes. And we used to go out and we'd be out in the community meeting people, and people say, how do you know each other? Oh, we're brothers. Yeah, we got the same dad. And people would just look at us and go, oh, okay. You know, but it's like that was our relationship. It's like we are brothers. We are brothers and sisters, and we got the same Father in heaven. So this morning, I don't know what the world's beating you up with. I don't know what's going on. I don't know what challenges everybody's dealing with. But I want you to think about the love and character of God through his Son. Because as it says in Ephesians 3, just a little bit later, And it says, and it's one of those scriptures that you just got to think about. It says, starting a little bit later in verse 17, I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide, long, and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with measure to the fullness of God. So this morning, take time to grasp how wide, deep, and how expansive God's love is. That as we come together, that we're united together to worship our Lord. Amen?
Amen.
So let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you so much, God, just for this time to be together. God, there's challenges in the world. There's hostilities in the world. God, we see shootings in schools. We see racial divide. We see economical divide. We see so many ways that the world wants to separate us and tear us apart. God, I pray that this morning, God, that you just help us to pray for those that are hurting. God, to comfort those in the world, to help them to see, God, how wide and deep your love is. God, I pray that you help us to be what we need to be, God, to glorify you through this time. Pray that you bless this worship. God, help us to be united in your Son. In Jesus' name, amen.
Go ahead and stand with me as we continue singing.
Sing of Jesus and his word. Sing.
Please turn your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 6. So, we got finals coming up. This was my first year teaching, aka my first year ever making more than a minimal amount of money. And it was awesome. Making money is great. But for me, it's just really tempting to want to have total control over how I spend that money. And I think it's just my nature to want to make sure that whatever I'm spending my money on is somehow directly benefiting myself. And so I just love this scripture. I think it just really speaks for itself. So in verse 17 of chapter 6 in 1 Timothy, it says, command those who are rich. This is Paul talking to Timothy. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasures for themselves in heaven, treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. I love that. It says that giving is the life that is truly life. And so this scripture, it really tells us not to put our hope in wealth. It's very uncertain. I feel like no matter how much I make, I always want more. And the scripture also commands us to put our hope in God, not in our paychecks. I often find myself saying, like, you know, I'll take care of that errand or that chore next week once I get paid. Instead of those things, we must be rich in good deeds. And using our money generously is a part of that. So today, as the Bachelor passed, please just examine your heart. Are you putting your hope in what you have now, or are you putting your hope in how God can use what you have now? With that, let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for today, and just for the beautiful spring day you've provided us, and just this family you've provided us. Father, I pray that today, even on Special Contribution Sunday, that we can be generous and humble, and serving God, and give past our comfort zones. Father, I pray that you bless what we give today so that we can do greater things for your kingdom in the days to come. Lord, I love you very much. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Go ahead and stand together as we sing this next song.
Sovereign Lord, Almighty King, Creator of all many things, the Architect of all that's pure, we are so weak, but we are sure. God will take our weakness, work our incompleteness, fill our broken hearts by His great compassion. God will joy to see, bring that news to me, God will.
God will do.
Amen. Let's continue singing before communion. All to Jesus I surrender.
My name is Casey, and this is my beautiful wife, Christina. We've been married for almost 2 years. Oh, God. We're making it. We're doing it. So we had the privilege of doing the communion message today, and I think over the past, like, month, 6 weeks or so, we've really been trying to refocus, recenter our relationship around God. And a couple of things we've been really working on is just our communication, especially like in our arguments and stuff, really making sure that I'm still being respectful, watching my tone, and loving her, and, you know, I think vice versa.
I'm sorry. I was doing good.
And then, like, we have really busy schedules. We work a lot of opposite shifts, and so with the time that we have, I think we've been trying to be as intentional with that as possible. So, but Christina's been reading this book, and I think that was kind of her turning point, like with everything that we've been trying to work on. And I'd let her explain that a little bit and read a little bit from that. So
the book's called Fierce Marriage, Radically Pursuing Each Other in Light of Christ's Relentless Love. And I heard about the book because the authors also have a podcast I listen to on the way to work, and it's all very biblically based, and they're very raw and honest and open, which is kind of hard to find about marriage books that are also Christian based. So they really just tie a lot about what marriage is and back to the message of the cross, and I think that it was just really inspiring to me. So I'll read a couple of things from it, and then Casey will kind of tie it all together. So, a marriage crashes when we stop asking, what does it mean to worship God in this situation, and what good works can I do in this situation, and when we start asking, how can I get my own way? You don't fight for your marriage as much as Christ uses your marriage to fight for you. You don't pursue your spouse's heart as much as Christ uses your spouse's to pursue your heart. You don't prize your spouse's affection with nearly the same ferocity with which Christ prizes yours. That's the most exciting, albeit counterintuitive, aspect of marriage. It's not about you. It's all about Jesus, and it always has been. Just as a complete gospel diagnoses the sickness, it also administers the cure. The gospel revolutionizes marriage by showing us what it means to realistically expect from each other. But it doesn't leave us there. It also carries us forward. God rescues us from death, sets our feet on solid ground, and shows us a better way to love. 1 Corinthians 12:31. The experience of God's love in Christ forever changes how you love each other in three tangible ways. First, Jesus shows us that real love is vastly more powerful, costly, and rewarding than anything offered by the world. Our human definition of love pales in comparison to God's. The gospel shows us God's incomparable love, empowers us to love in a similar way, and assures us that loving each other according to God's design won't always be easy, but is always worth it. Next, the gospel shows us exactly what covenant means and what we can expect to accomplish when we submit ourselves to loving each other within covenantal boundaries. Imagine how your marriage would be if both of you based your choice to love not on the other person's performance, but on the promises you've made. Finally, experience the gospel transforms how you love by flooding your heart with grace, empathy, patience, and capacity to forgive. The experience of radical grace multiplies the grace you feel for others, especially your spouse. You're compelled to love your spouse radically because of the radical love you've been given. You've been under grace's knife. You know how that surgery feels. You've experienced for yourself what it's like to need Christ's righteousness to replace your own. And you now count your forgiveness as a priceless gift. The greater your experience of grace, the larger your capacity to give it. If he who is forgiven little loves little, Luke 7:47, then it follows that the opposite is also true. He who is forgiven much loves much. Prior to experiencing forgiveness, one might say, how dare they sin against me? But after sitting at death's door and being rescued from its hold, one would rather say, how can I possibly hold their sins against them? This shift in heart orientation brought on by the gospel forever changes how you love each other in marriage. Every time you love your spouse when it's hard, you reflect the unrelenting love of God in Christ. Every time you uphold your covenant, despite wanting to give up, you mirror God's unfailing promise to redeem his people. And every time you enjoy oneness and unity and intimacy, you foreshadow the unity and oneness that God's people, the bride, will experience with Jesus and the bridegroom in heaven. It's scary to be open, to be seen for who you are with all your faults, flaws, and failures, but that's exactly how Jesus loves you, for who you are. Amen. That's the person he died for, you. It's the same for your spouse, and God saw it good in his infinite wisdom to pair you together for the journey of redemption. The ultimate goal of this journey is the transformation of your heart into one that mirrors Jesus.
Amen. Yeah, so I think like that chapter, that's one of the first couple chapters, and it's literally just about love. And there's plenty of scriptures out there about how Jesus' relationship with God mirrors, or how our relationship, our marriage, is supposed to mirror Jesus' relationship with the church. And I think the big thing about that chapter that really stood out is just the infinite amount of grace that he gave us, how much he forgives us, and who he died for. He died for me at my worst. He died for Christina at his worst. And because of that sacrifice, I got to marry Christina. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's, you know, this, the massive amount of gifts he's given me because of his sacrifice that he made out of pure love for me at my worst is, you know, there's nothing I can do to say thank you enough. So the biggest, this last little quote here, it says, marriage isn't about you. It isn't even about your marriage. Ultimately, your marriage is about proclaiming the power and glory of Jesus Christ. And so that's you know, that's how I say thank you to God for sending his son down for his sacrifice, is by using my marriage to set an example in a godly way, and, you know, bringing people, you know, to his kingdom. So with that, we'll go ahead and pray for communion. Dear Father, I thank you so much just for sending your son down here, Lord, and just how much you love us, Lord, just how incomparable your love is to any amount of love I can give to anybody, my wife, you know, my family here, people in the ministry, Lord. It's just, it's something that I'm so, so very grateful for today, every day, Lord. I know that it's just, you know, it just shows how much you love each and every one of us here today, Lord, that you sent down your son, that way we can have a relationship with you, Lord. I pray that every day we just put our lives at the cross. We're able to glorify you, Lord. Say thank you. Show our love. We're able to forgive. We're able to give grace as it was given to us, Lord. I love you very much. I pray this all in your son's name. Amen.
You want to stand with me as we continue singing for the message.
Greetings from the Caribbean islands and from the churches there. My name is Charmaine Henry, for those who don't know me. I'm a professor of biology at Baker University. I teach online. About 2 years ago, I moved back to Antigua, which is my native land, to take care of my mom, who faces multiple health challenges. And so for 2 years, I've been there in the Caribbean taking care of her. And today, I want to share a little bit with you about what it's been like to be there. In Isaiah chapter 42, in verses 10 and 12, it says, "Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise from the ends of the earth, you who go down to the sea and all that is in it, you islands and all who live in them. Let them give glory to the Lord and proclaim his praise in the islands." And really, I sometimes feel like I'm at the end of the earth. I am currently the only disciple on my island. The closest church is on another island that only takes 15 minutes to get there by plane. So you have to fly there, and it's expensive, so I can't go there every week. And you know, there are 10 islands that actually have churches on them, churches of disciples, but disciples are scattered over about 200 islands. So for those of us who don't actually live where there's a church planted, we have to travel however we can to get there, and it's not always easy. But God is faithful. He said he would never forsake us. He is God of the whole earth. Amen. Even unto the ends of the earth, he is with us, no matter where we are. And so whether you have to take a boat, or you have to take a plane, or paddle, or go down the river, or however you get there, you try to get there. And if you can't afford to get there, thank God for technology. Amen. because you can, if you have internet, which doesn't always happen, but you can email, you can Facebook, you can WhatsApp, you know, there's all kinds of ways to communicate. And so we have learned to be very good with our communication and to be very faithful with keeping in touch with each other. So I'm in Antigua and I'm teaching online. So I came back to Baker this week for the final exams. My exams have all been given, grades turned in. My students are graduating, praise God. And so on Tuesday, I leave to go back to the Caribbean. But you know, when you're there on an island and you're the only one, and it's, you can't just walk down the road and visit another disciple, right? And we go through hurricanes, and so sometimes the internet system is down, and sometimes you can go for days and weeks and sometimes even months without actually seeing another disciple's face. What do you do? I think of the Apostle John. You know, there was a time in his life when he lived on an island, and we don't know if there were other disciples with him, but we do know he was on the Isle of Patmos, and I'm sure he felt very alone. And when you're alone on an island and you can't just walk across the street and see another disciple, what is your focus? What should your focus be? Yeah. I know for me, it is just to keep God center, front, forward as the center of my life. What did John do? He didn't focus on himself, and he didn't say, oh, poor me, I'm here all alone, and I can't see Peter and John, and Peter and Paul and all the others. He didn't say that. John, if you read his books, you see that he focused on love for God, love for the other disciples, love for those who didn't know God, and he sought ways to serve them. Yeah. And if you read his books focus on love. They focus on the victory of the church, the majesty, the glory, the power, the dominion of God, and the ultimate victory when God comes back to claim his own. And so those are the things I try to focus on. When it gets really challenging taking care of mom, when she doesn't like anything I cook, you know, and she doesn't want to take her meds, you know, she doesn't want to go anywhere and get exercise and try to walk around, I pull out my Bible and I start just looking at God's power, God's glory, God's majesty, and how the earth, the whole earth is his no matter where you are. You could be in the middle of the desert, the middle of a jungle, sailing across the ocean, no other ship in sight. God is with you. And he promises that he will never leave you, he'll never forsake you. And so you are here, and you can see each other day to day. You can just walk down the road or drive down the road, you can see each other. You know, you have so much to be thankful for. Do not take for granted what you have here in the United States as disciples of Jesus Christ. God has given you so many resources to proclaim his word, to take care of each other, to seek and save the lost. Use them. You know, use what God has given you. Dedicate everything to him. Put it all in his hands and let him lead you. Amen. You know, last year we went through some really horrible hurricanes, and you might have heard about it. And in some islands, disciples have lost their homes. Now, I haven't heard of anyone who died, but we face so many challenges, and we're in the process of rebuilding. In my own country, the country is made up of two islands, Antigua and Barbuda. The bigger island is Antigua. That's where I live. The smaller island is Barbuda. It had about 1,600 people. The hurricane flattened it. And only one little child died. We moved everyone over to the big island. And they're in the process now of rebuilding. But it's very, very challenging. And you know, it helps you to see that you must focus on God. When you look out the window and your whole world has been blown away, who do you turn to? You know, my mom's house is kind of falling apart because we have a termite problem, and you really can't ever get rid of termites except to tear everything down and rebuild. She doesn't really want to do anything about the house, so the challenge is getting her to agree we need to rebuild this house. But in the meantime, we're patching it here and there. But I walk around the house, you know, you hear termites rustling in the walls, the floorboards are a little bit weak. And, you know, it teaches me not to put my hope and put my trust on anything material, because the things that are material will go away. You know, the termites will eat the wood, the house will fall apart. You know, things around us will go. Only God is eternal. Only God is secure. Put your hope and your trust in him. He is our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. And he is your refuge and your strength too. And so as you go through the remainder of the year, always think that if all else goes, you know, if you lose everything, if you look out and there's nothing left, who do you turn to? You turn to the Lord God Almighty. To him be the power and the glory and the honor. pray for us in the islands. We have a lot of work ahead of us. I will be starting to work with the teens to teach character studies. It's hard with the adults, but they're willing to let us help the children. And so that's what we're going to do. Okay, so pray for us as I pray for all of you. God bless you, and it's good to see you all again. Thanks.
I don't even know why I'm up here, right? That was, my goodness. Charmaine, it is so, we miss you so much. It's so good to see you and hear from you. Very inspired by your faith and your life that's like Jesus. So thank you very, very much. Just a couple quick announcements. The church is in need of a push lawnmower. So if anybody has one that they would like to donate, talk to Rich Augustine. Okay, and guys, keep a lookout on your emails, because we don't know when, but it could be soon. Because of all the construction, there may come a time where we won't be able to use our parking lot. So please, we're going to be communicating to the church through email about what we're going to do on Sundays if we're not able to use the parking lot and where we're going to park and all that kind of stuff. So just be on the lookout for that in the next coming weeks. I think we had an engagement, right, yesterday, Jackson and Kaylee. Congrats. And lastly, just prayers for, we have a lot of people traveling this summer. As you can see, the room is half the size it usually is. We've got several students traveling for ministry training programs. We're going to have people going to camps. We've got people that are going to be traveling. I think Michael's going to be in 8 different countries this summer. So we got people going all over for Hope Youth Corps. Please pray for their safety, but also we've got a lot of young Christians that are going to different places for the summer. And I'm sure a lot of us can remember what that was like and the difficulties that can bring. So let's just really pray and keep everybody that's not here on our minds and our hearts as the weeks go on. Okay, so kind of getting into it today. Today is our Mission Sunday. Once a year, okay, our family of churches around the world are taking up a special collection to raise as much money as possible to advance the mission, to advance the gospel all over the world. And today's that day where we take up that collection, or at least around this month. My hope for today is to kind of broaden our perspective on why that's important and how our offering really has a great influence around the world. And I'm privileged to be a part of a Eurasian Missions Board, okay? For those of you who don't know, the church here in Lawrence and our family of churches in the Heartland region, we support churches all over Russia. Along with Texas and Canada and LA, we financially and relationally support, I can't remember exactly how many, but several churches all over Russia. It's a huge area and a lot of disciples over there. I think between 3,000 and 4,000 disciples over there. And our offering today goes not only just to do work here locally, but to help advance the gospel over there as well. And I've been privileged to be able to go travel over there and be on the Eurasian Mission Board that kind of oversees how that finances are used over there, and really get to see firsthand the impact that our offering, even just here in Lawrence, is able to have. And I think sometimes being in a small church and Russia being so far away, it can seem, it's hard to really grasp. It just kind of can seem like something we're putting into a plate, and that's about as far as our imagination can go with it. Right. And so I want to share today, hopefully to inspire us, to really help us to continue to give. And the question I want to start with is, what is the mission? Right? What is the mission? And this is something that last week we met down in Texas as a board, and we were able to discuss what is the mission. And I'm sharing today some of what we talked about. But we read in Matthew 28, 18 through 20, Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. We also look in Luke 24, verse 46. He told them, this is what is written, the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. Guys, the mission is simple. To spread the gospel to all nations. Now, most of us, when we hear all nations, we think of countries, right? There are, you know, there are 195 recognized countries in the world. Or 196, depending on who you talk to, in the UN, okay? And those countries are what's known as geopolitical entities, all right? This is just an area that has political structure that's helping to govern it. When we read these scriptures, all nations, this is where most of our minds go, okay? And we read Matthew 28, go spread the gospel to every geopolitical entity in the all 195 of them. That's kind of our translation of that. That's the lens we read it through. And as a family of churches, International Church of Christ, we have around 600 churches that are spread out over 150 of those 195 geopolitical entities. That is extremely encouraging, but I think sometimes when we're reading it like that, it can kind of enable us to settle in a little bit because it kind of gives the illusion that, well, there's still work to be done. I mean, we've made a lot of progress. And, you know, at one point there was this, you know, huge push, this urgency. And then, wow, 150 out of 100. You know, and some of those we aren't even able to get into. So we're doing pretty good. But Jesus is not talking about geopolitical entities. That's too broad. And so we see a picture of what Jesus is actually talking about in Revelation 7, verse 9. At the end of the story, right? After this, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. Panta ta ethne. That is the translation for all nations. And it's not talking about geopolitical entities. It's actually talking about ethno-linguistic people groups. Now, when you focus on those countries, those political structured countries, 150 out of 200, man, that's great. But what Jesus is talking about, go make disciples of every nation, every people, every language, every culture, every tribe, every single people group. An ethno-linguistic people group is a group of people that shares language, culture, and worldview. And there's actually somewhere between 12 and 20,000 of those in the world. So when you read that scripture like Jesus meant it, our 150, there's a lot of work to be done. Yes. Jesus wasn't just talking about the broad landscape of these 200 countries that span over the entire world. He's talking about every single little people, all those little islands that Charmaine's talking about, every people group all over the world. I want everyone to hear it. What's the mission? Well, it's much greater than I think most of us can really grasp at times. And I think the question that we have to ask ourselves is, do you care about all 15,000 of those people groups? Because the reality is, the big ones really get focused on, and then the little ones, well, you know, that little tiny one, you know, we can't reach them all. We try. Now, not to criticize anybody, I think everybody's trying to do as much as they can. That's really all we can do. But guys, we've got to broaden our care. We've got to broaden our view of the mission to every single group of people in the world. Yes. Not just here in Kansas or here in the United States, but all those little islands that you don't even know exist. I think I read somewhere, we actually talked about it at this board meeting, that there were at least 4,000 to 6,000 of those people groups that have never even heard who Jesus is. Right? And I think a lot of that blew my mind, because I think a lot of us, we live in this age where it's kind of like, okay, everybody has had to have at least heard of something about Jesus at this point. Wow, but there, guys, let that sink in. There are groups of people in this world that have no, that have not even yet heard who Jesus is. Now, even if it's just a tiny group out all the way in the middle of nowhere that speaks some sort of a dialect or a language that we, that, you know, isn't even recorded, even them, even that group needs to hear the gospel. Amen. The mission is great. And I think the next question we have to ask ourselves is, how important is this offering that we give? Wow, could a little, a small church, 100 to 150 people collecting some money, is it really going to have that great of an impact? And I don't think we realize how wealthy of a country we are, that your $20, you know, can reach far greater than what it can over here. But there's an example of this in 2 Corinthians, which you can go ahead and turn there. That's where we're going to be. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. You know, Paul and some other evangelists are traveling around the world to spread the gospel. And they go to these different churches. They're spending time with these churches, and the request is for each of these churches to help sacrifice financially to continue the spreading of the gospel. They go somewhere, they spread the gospel, a church is planted and began, leaders are put into place to help take care of that church, and then that church provides finances for them to continue to go to the next place, and on and on and on and on. And so Paul, he's writing to the church in Corinth, and he's telling them about these churches in Macedonia. And what we read, apparently this group of churches was two things: poor and really going through a difficult time. Don't know what that is. Don't know the level of poverty. But that's some of the details we get. Let's start in verse 1 of 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people. And they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God also to us. So we urge Titus, just as he had earlier made a beginning, to bring also to completion this act of grace on your part. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. I'm not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And here's my judgment about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now, finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. The goal is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. And so he's writing to the church in Corinth, and apparently, when the church in Corinth was planted, they gave very generously. And so he's writing them a second time, asking for them to continue the work that they had started. And he's telling them about these other churches that have been planted and these other churches that have been giving to the mission. And he's asking the church in Corinth, hey, you guys gave a few years ago. And all this was able to happen because of that giving. But you can't just stop there. You've got to finish what you started. We need you to give some more to continue the work. Let me tell you about this church in Macedonia. They're poor. They're in severe trial. But they gave richly beyond what they were able. And he kind of, I don't know what he's doing here. He's kind of, you know, hey, this isn't a command. I'm not commanding you. I just want to see how your love compares to that of the Macedonian churches. You know, just let's just see, right? And, you know, of course, okay, you know, no, I'm sure the church in Corinth was like, well, fine, it's not a command, you know, so we're not going to do it. No, right? What's his point here? You got to finish what you started. And when I think about the churches in Russia, planted late 80s, early 90s, man, the gospel was spread. Thousands of people became Christians. And churches over here in the United States help support that financially, relationally, you name it. The work's not done.
That's right.
We've got to continue to help finish what was started. It's not, hey, man, look what happened, you know, 20, 30 years ago. That was awesome. No, we got to finish what was started. There's still so much work to be done there. They have one full-time campus ministry couple in the whole country. Wow. Okay, they have no elders in the entire country. I think it's hard for us to explain the Russian culture. One of the things we talked about in the board meeting, the Russian culture is very much so Soviet, tough, suck it up, deal with it. And so the idea of grief or counseling or processing things in a healthy way doesn't even exist over there. So you've got generations of people that have just suck it up, be tough, don't deal with anything. And you can imagine that going on for generation after generation. It can just weigh on people. And it's not that there's no one there to help them deal with it. It's not even a concept. So they're not even sitting there thinking, man, I really wish I had someone to help counsel me through this grief because I'm really having a hard time. They just don't even understand that they need it. So part of what's going on is putting in place programs to train people, to help counsel people. That's just one little tiny need of hundreds. Guys, there's work to be done. We've got to finish what was started. And there's a couple things I think we can learn from the Macedonian churches. And number one, that's their attitude toward giving. I love that verse 2. Their overflowing joy. You know, do we view special missions contribution as a joy? And in verse 4, it says that they begged Paul to let them give so that they could join in on the privilege. Do we view special missions contribution as, are you going up to the leaders in the church begging them to give more financially to help the mission? I kind of get the feeling that Paul arrived there, saw the difficulty they were going through and their poverty, and probably didn't bother to ask. That would just be my guess. You know, knowing Paul, knowing all his other letters, he didn't ever want to put church in a situation that burdened them. I bet he shows up, saw their situation, was like, I don't need you guys. I'll figure it out. We'll figure it out another way. And I kind of get the picture that they, you know, find out other churches, hey, Paul, hey, what? Why don't you ask us if we could help with the mission? Well, yeah, no, please, let us help. Please, let us give so we can continue the work. They begged him for the opportunity to join in this privilege. And verse 8 is really interesting because apparently our love is connected toward our giving. That's really interesting, especially we know how important love is throughout the scriptures. Love your neighbor. We know that. We talk about love all the time. But, wow, Paul's saying that our love is connected. There's a correlation between the finances we sacrifice and give and how much we love. It's really interesting. Yeah. You know, do you view giving as just a routine? Do you view it as an obligation so you won't get in trouble with God? Do you view it as a tax, right? Or do you view it joyfully and you beg for the opportunity to give in order to help somebody else? I think we can learn a lot about the attitude of the Macedonians. The next thing we can learn is their sacrifice. It says they gave beyond what they were able. You know, I think a lot of times we want to see more happen without having to sacrifice more, right? I'm going to give the same amount I've given for the last 10 years, but I want to see more happen now than I saw 10 years ago. The reality is it takes sacrifice for the work to get done. If we want to see more happen, it's going to take more sacrifice. And guys, we got to remember, sacrifice means it interferes with your life. Yeah. I think a lot of us, it's like, and myself included, I'll give as much as I can before it will actually interfere with my daily life, right? Most of us, I'm not going to say all because I'm sure that that's not true, but a lot of us, we probably will give our special missions contribution and be able to continue on with our daily life as usual. I don't know if anyone, I think everyone's still going to have their car after special missions, or their TV, or their cell phone, or their home, or their bed, or their clothes, you know, their nice clothes. I know you know, we'll give some of the clothes to a garage sale or whatever. There's nothing wrong with that. But the reality is, most of us are still able to live an extremely comfortable life, normal life, privileged life, and still give. Mm-hmm. How much more work could be done if we actually interfered with our normal life? If we actually sacrificed? Now, guys, we have an extremely sacrificial church. I've been here for 10 years. I don't think we've ever missed our special missions goal. We've always, I think, exceeded it. This church is extremely sacrificial. So I'm not trying to condemn anyone. I'm trying to, I wonder just how much further the mission could go. Yeah. Man, if we took stepped a little bit further, just sacrificed a little bit more and viewed it as a privilege, not just an obligation, an excitement. It says they gave beyond what they were able. Sacrifice. And he brings Jesus into the picture. In verse 9, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich. And Jesus is the ultimate example of this. Choosing to interfere with his norm, to become poor willingly to help others, so that others could be taken care of. You know, I know a lot of the campus aren't here. Hopefully they'll watch this on the live stream. But I remember when we were in the campus ministry and we set a goal that every campus student give $500 for special contribution. And everybody did. Everybody did. And I think, you know, our church now is about half campus students. And so, I'd be willing to bet you go through and tally up all the, you know, probably most of the special is coming from half of the church, right? And it's the other half, not the campus half. But I think we can kind of just succumb to that, I don't have anything. Well, yeah, if you don't actually sacrifice, you won't have it. If you just give out of what you have without your life being affected, then yeah, you don't have anything. But I think we can give beyond what we're able. And I'm talking wherever the camera is, I'm talking to all of you that aren't here today, right? I want to challenge us, give beyond what you're able. And that will take sacrifice. That's going to take maybe affecting your norm. And Paul goes into, he references the scripture in Exodus. I want to turn there. Exodus 16, verse 16. And this is when the Israelites have been taken out of Egypt. They're in the desert. They're grumbling. Oh, Moses, what are we going to do? We're so thirsty. We're so hungry. You should have left us in Egypt. You know, I'd rather die there than starve to death out here, you know. And so God's like, okay. You know, so we get into the manna and the quail and all that. Verse 16, this is what the Lord has commanded. Everyone is to gather as much as they need. Take an omer, which is about 3 pounds, for each person you have in your tent. The Israelites did as they were told. Some gathered much, some gathered little. And when they measured it by the omer, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. Everyone had gathered just as much as they needed. Then Moses said to them, no one is to keep any of it until morning. However, some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning, but it was full of maggots and it began to smell. It's really interesting in this context. So Paul is talking to the church about sacrificing to take care of the needs of the other churches so that the churches would have their needs met equally. And he references this story. And what God's telling the Israelites is, you got to realize, guys, they were starving, they were thirsty, they were, you know, thought they were about to die out in the desert. So God throws just food, meat and bread, just everywhere. I mean, just imagine looking outside and there's just food just laid out everywhere as far as you can look. You can imagine the tendency would be to run out there and just take, you get your family, you get everybody in your tent, you grab all the fish you can, you store it up, and, you know, we're starving, we got to, and God says, I don't want you, if you store more than you need, it's going to rot and stink up your house. You take what you need, don't take more. If you have a big family, you take the amount that your family needs, don't take more than that, or it's going to stink the place up, it's going to rot. If you have a tiny family, you take just enough. You don't, you know, be a hoarder. Don't get hangry. Just take what you need and trust me. I want everyone to take what they need. And so Paul is applying this same principle to the churches in the first century. I want each of you to have what you need. Don't be a hoarder. Or it's going to rot and it's going to stink. I want everyone to have what they need. I don't want anyone to have too little. And I also don't want some family in this big old tent, you know, storing everything up and trying to, you know, whatever. Take exactly what you need. Guys, that's what God's desire is for his churches around the world. And I think what we have to realize is there is a reality of how fortunate we are to live in this country. We have plenty. And frankly, a lot of us, we probably have more than we need. And it rots and it stinks. That's what materialism does. That's what greed does. We just store it up. Man, I need this, I need this, I need this. And it's like, it rots. It stinks up our household. When there are people across the world that don't have enough. And he's saying the goal is equality. I want the churches in America to have what they need. And I want the churches in Russia to have what they need. I don't want you to have too much. I don't want you to have too little. And there's going to come a day, which this is probably impossible for us to fathom, because the history of the world is only, you know, a couple hundred years old when America was founded. There will come a day when the tables will turn. And America won't be this huge wealthy powerhouse. And guess what? I want you guys not to have too much, just what you need, and you to sacrifice so that they can have what they need. The goal is equality. So, guys, what's the mission? To some extent, equality for our churches. It's so that every single group of people around the world have the equal opportunity to hear the gospel as every other group of people around the world. And our collection goes further than you think. You may throw in $50. You send that over to Russia. That enables some person to travel, to get training, to go back home and help take care of 100 people. It goes so much further than you can imagine. You're putting roofs over kids' heads. You're giving people opportunity to hear the gospel. You're giving churches the opportunity to mature. Our giving goes a long way. And what I want to encourage is to give beyond what you're able to sacrifice. Interfere with your norm, with your comfort. We have plenty, guys. Let's give so that everybody has an equal chance to hear the gospel and everybody has their needs met. Not too much, not too little. Amen. Amen. So if you are giving today, amen. If you were prepared, if you weren't prepared and you're like scrambling to, I think it's okay for you to take a week and just pray. Amen. Well, I wasn't prepared. I didn't set a goal a year ago and say, you know, I don't know what, we just threw a number out. You know, we're asking everyone to give 11 to 12 times what their weekly is, but I don't know. If you heard something today that kind of struck you, maybe take a week to sleep on it, pray about it, and really think, okay, what can I sacrifice so that churches across the world can have what they need? If you're not here this week, if you're at MIT, fortunately, we have an app, right? But guys, I really just want us to really think and pray about what can we do to help take care of the needs of our brothers and sisters across the world. Amen? So we're going to pray, and then we're going to take up our collection. If you are giving on the app online, you'll see that there are specific, you know, Topeka, Free State, Special Contribution Topeka, Free State, Special Contribution Lawrence. So there's specific places that you can go in and give. If you're not giving on the app, then don't worry about that. But let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll take up our special missions contribution, and we'll close out with one more song. Amen? God, thank you so much for the opportunity, for the privilege to be able to give to your mission. God, the mission is great. I think it's greater than we can even understand. God, there are the fact that there are 4,000+ groups of people that haven't even heard of who Jesus is amazing. God, there's so much more work to be done. And we can start today. God, I pray that we would sacrifice, that we would have the right attitude toward giving. God, that our hearts would be there and that we would really see it as an opportunity to advance the gospel, to help people around the world and even locally, not just in Russia, but here in Lawrence even, hear the gospel and have a changed life, have a changed marriage, give their kids the opportunity to have a changed life, and on and on and on. God, I pray that we wouldn't withhold from you, and I pray that we would take just what we need. God, that we wouldn't be a church that hoards, that as individuals we wouldn't hoard and stink up and rot up our house, but God, that we'd be sacrificial, that we would take what we need, and that we could supply the needs of the churches across the world. God, please, I pray with this collection that you would multiply it, God, that it would change people's lives, that the gospel would be spread because of it. We love you very much. We're very thankful for you. It's in your Son Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Go ahead and stand as the basket's being passed. We'll close out with one last song. If you have kids downstairs after the basket goes by, you're welcome to go down and get them and relieve the teachers. Thank you.